Good morning. I'm Ed Pentz, Executive Director of CrossRef. Welcome to the meeting today. It's great to see so many people here. We've got a great agenda for you today. I'm going to start off just giving a little bit of an overview of some CrossRef statistics, and then I'll be handing over to a couple of other CrossRef staff to give updates on various things that we're working on. Just to let you know today that the presentations are being recorded, video and audio. There are a couple of mics here, so if you have questions or discussions, please use the microphone so that'll get picked up for the recording, and then within a week we'll make them available on the website. And other than that, I think I will just get started. And so what I want to do today is just look at some of the key CrossRef statistics just to see how things are going. The first statistic is just looking at the number of DOIs that have been registered. And you can see that we are rapidly approaching having 57 million DOIs. And you can see the growth here since 2002 has been steady and pretty dramatic. I've got a breakdown of the different content types. It's been journal backfiles and now increasingly book backfiles that are leading to this growth. But what it means is that there's a ton of content that can be linked from and to, and it really makes it an extensive linking network that we've built up. So now looking at the breakdown of content, 83% journal articles. Books are at 10%. Last year they were 8%, so books are growing faster than journals, although still a relatively small part. And then we have conference proceedings, which have remained fairly steady, and then components at 1%. Components are where publishers identify pieces of an article or a book chapter, so figures, tables, supplementary data, that type of stuff. And we have a number of publishers who are starting to do that across the board, but it's only a handful of publishers who are doing that at the moment. One of the things that came up in the business meeting, the treasurer's report that Ian Bannerman gave, was about the CrossRef finances, and one of our main sources of revenue is deposit fees, and the biggest category for deposit fees are journals. So we always look very carefully at these figures to see how they're going. We've been expecting the journal backfile deposits to drop off. We haven't seen that, except we may be seeing that now. So I can reveal this as hot off the presses news. So this is the graph of current year journals DOI deposits with CrossRef since 2007. So you can see that starting off here, we've had a sort of nice steady growth, leveling off a little bit. And I think, you know, as more and more publishers join, obviously there's going to be less and less growth. I mean, you have the growth in publishers publishing more articles, that type of thing. But I think we can expect to see that leveling off. If we look at the backfile journals, a little bit more up and down. So with various publisher digitizations, it's sort of gone up and down. 2011 was one of the biggest years, but you can see that our estimate for the end of 2012 is to actually be down. We're still at a level equal with 2007. So that's meant, again, a lot of content going into the system, but it'll be interesting to see for 2013. I think we'll expect that. I mean, we are projecting for that to go down a little bit more. But if you think of all the years of backfile deposits we've had, that's where we've gotten to the 57 million CrossRef DOIs. If we look at the picture with books, little bit different. We've had more steady growth, but that coming from 2007, where it was almost down to zero, where we started off, because obviously we started registering books a little bit later than we did journal articles, but we've had nice steady growth, and for the last 2 years in particular, we've seen steady growth, and we're expecting that that growth to continue. So we're up to a position now where we're getting over 500,000 book DOIs a month. That's about 350,000 book titles that have been registered in CrossRef. There are 178 publishers depositing book content with CrossRef, mostly at the chapter level. So that's a whole other set of content to link, to interlink. The linking is less than with books. Book references, references in books are a lot more variable. They're harder to link. A lot of publishers still have the chapters in PDF. That's something that we're going to be looking at in the future. We're doing some work on reference extraction technology, and starting with journals, but in future that'll work with books. Now the picture with book backfiles is very interesting. You can see obviously we've really kicked in here, and as the journal deposits have gone down, the book backfile deposits have gone up to compensate partially for that. We can see here some of the big publishers have done backfiles. Springer did their book backfiles. I think Taylor and Francis may have done some, and Wiley as well. And Elsevier is doing a lot with books, and we're seeing a lot of, again, smaller organizations registering their books as well. So that's all looking very healthy, and as the journals go down, the books are going up, so that's worked out quite well. The other key aspect of the system is what we call, we refer to as queries and matches. So we get lots of references sent to us from many different types of organizations, looking for DOIs because they want to create links to full text. So that's coming in from publishers, abstracting and indexing databases, libraries, all sorts of types of organizations are doing that. And this is a chart that shows here the number of queries in each year since 2007, and then the number of matches. So these are the references coming in, and these are the DOIs, the CrossRef DOIs that we've matched. And you can see again here, the growth was kind of going up, but again, 2011, 2012, a real acceleration, and it's been fantastic that the system has been able to cope with that. There's been a lot of work behind the scenes. Chuck's going to be talking about some of that. But this year we might actually hit, this is based on an estimate, we could be getting to, a billion queries this year, which I think is pretty amazing. And we've also now nicely seen a jump in the actual number of DOIs. That's the underlying matching rate has gone up as well. The matching rate varies hugely depending on who's doing the querying. Some organizations come back and re-query stuff that they've queried before and it hasn't matched. So it's really all over the place. But it is nice to see that the system is coping very, very well. And I'll talk a little bit later about I think what that means in terms of the querying. But we have gone global in a big way. We have 3,500 participating organizations from 81 different countries around the globe. So that's been great to see that happening. This is just a quick little map I did. I think this is my rough estimate of where CrossRef staff have visited over the last 18 months. So going global means that we've got to, staff is traveling more. But there's interest sort of all over the globe, except I think that's a target for 2013 to visit Africa. Although having said that, we are working with Africa journals online, and a number of different publishers are. So we've got DOIs from these countries. Just to highlight, actually, in the annual report, which you have in your meeting packs, there's a nice graph there showing the sort of global reach of CrossRef and the different types of members in different countries. It's very nice. And also there's the finances in there as well, if you weren't at the business meeting earlier today. So just a reminder, we'll be covering some of these things today. CrossRef has developed many different services. We've got our core reference linking, cited by linking, CrossRef metadata services, CrossCheck, and CrossMark. We'll be hearing about most of these later today, but I think we've got a real nice suite of services here for the industry. We also partner with a number of organizations that are very important. With iParadigms is our partner with CrossCheck. CrossCheck is powered by the Authenticate system. That's the system, iParadigm system. We also work with Inera and their X-Styles product, and we're still in a partnership with Adapon, providing system support. So what are we working on? Again, we're going to be hearing about a number of things today. Very exciting work is being done on PDF reference extraction, new tools for publishers, deposit and query system improvements. We're working in the back, so the back end system, we've got a new accounting system that's been up and running this year. So for next year, we're looking at a new CRM system, customer relationship management system. We're also working on FundRef, which is on the agenda for this afternoon. And as part of FundRef, which is something we haven't talked a lot about, is that we are also talking in a very sort of preliminary way to a number of organizations about signing CrossRef DOIs to grants themselves, which I think would be a good development. We're working on data and patent linking, text and data mining, and citation of open web content. So we'll be touching on all these things today. One thing that we won't be talking about a little bit later that's a very recent development is NISO has been organizing a group to get together and talk about metadata for open access indicators. There's also a UK-based project, vocabularies for open access, that's being done by JISC and UConn. So we've also been talking to them. We think this is great data that will fit in very nicely with CrossMark. So CrossRef always has a lot on its plate. People, and it's great. People are always saying, you know, what should CrossRef should get involved in this. On the other hand, you know, we do have limited resources, so it's always tricky with the staff and the CrossRef board to figure out which direction to head. And there's a well-known quote from Steve Jobs about, a real sign of innovation is, you know, saying no to things. You know, it's important what you say no to is what you say yes to. But just, I won't go into this in any detail, but just to give you this idea, what we've found with the CrossRef board and the CrossRef staff is we've created this CrossRef roadmap, and we use this quite actively and update it frequently. The board has strategic board meetings, and we go through all of these topics, and we've kind of divided everything into the main strands that we're working on, and we've tried to work it out roughly on, you know, from the present to the future. As things get farther out, we have more experimental things and things that we're budgeting for 2013. And so this has worked out really well. And so a lot of what you're going to be hearing today are things that are being guided by this roadmap. So to wrap up, I wanted to just mention some of the things that CrossRef staff are thinking about at the moment. I was talking about those queries coming in, getting almost a billion queries. Now, if we compare those billion queries with the actual DOI resolutions, which is people clicking on DOIs, humans clicking on DOIs, we're probably looking about 500 million, which is a fantastic figure, but it's about half of what we're getting in on those other queries, which are largely machine use. So what we're seeing now, and this is not something we necessarily expected in the early days of CrossRef, but you know, machine use is much, much greater than human use. Metadata is really driving everything. You know, metadata has become crucial to so many different things, and CrossRef has a big, big set of metadata. We make it available in a lot of different ways, and so that's driving many, many different aspects of the scholarly publishing ecosystem. I wanted to also highlight to everybody here that the CrossRef metadata, the metadata that you deposit with us, that publishers deposit with us, gets displayed. So make sure it's complete and correct, cited by linking, many different applications that use and actually display the data. Originally, when CrossRef got started, it didn't get displayed. It was just used for the reference matching in the background. But increasingly, it's getting displayed. So make sure your metadata is complete and correct. Something that we're working on now and the board is going to be talking about tomorrow is this the branding between CrossRef and digital object identifiers and DOIs. There's been a growth of other registration agencies also assigning DOIs. CrossRef's had the DOI field to itself pretty much for the last for the last 12 years since it was founded, and so there's been a conflation of the CrossRef and the DOI brands. People talk about DOIs, and they really mean CrossRef. But what we're going to be increasingly emphasizing is that there's no such thing as a DOI. There's no such thing as a generic DOI. There's a CrossRef DOI. There's a data site DOI. There's now an entertainment ID registry, or an I'm not sure of the acronym, but it's movie labs. It's the movie industry assigning identifiers to DVDs and metadata about, and it's a real supply chain application for the movie industry. So it means that there's going to be lots of different identifiers out there, and they do different things, and they identify different types of data. So there's no generic DOI in effect. So we're going to be working on that over this next year. Crossmark is the answer, to everything. I think it's certainly, maybe not for everything, but it's certainly the answer to many issues that are confronting the industry today. Crossmark, we'll hear about this afternoon. It's getting going. It's a lot of publishers are working on it in their workflows, but I'm very excited by Crossmark. It addresses a lot of issues. One of them being something that's come up more recently is this issue of CC BY licensing. Of course, CrossRef is neutral about how publishers offer their content or whether they use CC BY, but if publishers do use CC BY, there's going to be a lot of copies of the version of record out there in the wild that's kind of uncontrollable. And there's the attribution aspect. Crossmark is a perfect tool to help deal with these issues about copies of versions of record and attribution, and actually focusing attention on the publisher-maintained version. So even though there are all these other versions out there, the key one, Crossmark, helps users identify and get to, but gives them a lot of extra information, and most importantly, gives them information about how content changes and updates to content. But we'll be talking about Crossmark this afternoon. So that was a very quick whirlwind. Just to finish up on a few things, CrossRef's success is most of its success is down to its staff, the great staff, many of whom are here today. But I just wanted to highlight this year since the last meeting we have added three new staff: Amy Bosworth and Mike Yalter in Linfield, and Rachel Lamy in Oxford. They're great additions to the team. The other thing I wanted to highlight is in terms of CrossRef's growth. This is our Oxford office about 18 months ago. Okay, so very small, don't even have desks. We're very frugal. I think somebody came in off the street and is working in the corner. I'm not sure what's going on there, but a year later, this is maybe 6 months ago, we had to develop a new transportation system. The office had grown so much that we had to implement some interesting features for the office of how we get around the office. So this is going to make some tea here in the Oxford office. So you can see here we've got a nice system there for quickly getting down to make some tea. But we've got a great day lined up for you. So without further ado, I will finish up. So thank you very much, and I'd be happy to take any quick questions before we move on with the agenda. Okay. Everybody happy? Good. Okay, great. Good. So I will, thank you.